today. First of all, I'd like to say happy Thanksgiving to all those who came and had a good Thanksgiving. But more importantly, I pray for those who didn't have a good Thanksgiving. That's what fellowship is all about. You see, there's people that didn't have a good Thanksgiving. There were some people that were locked up. There were some people that were addicted to some drug. There were some people that had Thanksgiving in a bottle. You know, we have to be thankful, and that's what Thanksgiving is all about, being thankful. It's not the turkey day. They'd say it. It's wonderful to have a turkey, especially if someone else pays for it and cooks it for you. That's even better. But you see, Thanksgiving is about thanks. I want to give you a little bit of history to understand where I'm going with this. The Pilgrims came to America, and does anyone know who did they thank when they came to America? To America.
God.
Right. So many people think that the Pilgrims came, and after 30 days they were there, they gave thanks to the Indians. Well, the Indians were wonderful people, but they were giving thanks to God. And you see, even President Washington, our first president, he made a statement that the Thanksgiving Day will be a day of praise to God. We have to remember that's what we're here for. But it leads into me what I want to talk about today. We can praise God all day long and all night long, but we need to praise with somebody and thank with somebody. That's like going to a nightclub by yourself and going into the club and hearing the music and you're all by yourself. What good is that? Or how about going out to a party and you see all the food there and all the music and you're only one there? You want to share it with somebody. You see, a lot of alcoholics, they don't want to drink by themselves. They want to what? Drink with somebody. We want to share with somebody. We want to share. You see, that's sharing God's love. We want to tell somebody how we love God. It comes down to fellowship. Fellowship is what it's all about. People ask, what is the nature of fellowship? In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 to 15 says, do not be yoked together with unbelievers. I love that one right there, and I'll get to that in a sec. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have in darkness? And what harmony is there between Christ and Baal? And what does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? See, fellowship is all that. What does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? How many here were unbelievers at one time in their life? So that means that you have something in common with an unbeliever. How many of you done things that God calls a sin? I guess you now have something in common with a sinner. How many of you don't really want to be in church every Sunday when you got other things to do? Let's be honest, there's always been something in your life at one point in your life. Sister Jackie's good. Always
good.
But what I'm trying to say is, we talk about fellowship. We talk about being a Christian. You see, I'm so tired of hearing other Christians say, especially in these hardcore churches, we need to watch who we fellowship with. Well, let's look at the Bible. How many times did Jesus fellowship with only the believers?
Never.
I believe that he had a wonderful dinner one time at a tax collector's house. And how much you want to bet there were some things that said that if they knew who Jesus was, they never would have said it.
Right.
I'll bet you there are some crude choices of words. I'll bet you there are some unique jokes said there, especially when the liquor flowed. And you knew they had Jesus was there. God was there in the midst of sinners. We need to fellowship with everybody. Now, fellowshipping is very important. This is like a little class. I'm going to tell you why. See, fellowshipping says, we are of the world, but we're not in the world. right? What's that mean? That means, let's say you're an alcoholic and you've been sober 30 days and you love God. That's not the time to go to a club and share Christ in a club where they're drinking alcohol because you're not ready. But when you are ready, you now have something to share with them that how to change your life. Why? Because you have been there. You have the same faults that they have. You can show them the same things of Christ. You need to do fellowshipping is fellowshipping with everybody. I'm proud to say that this building starting Monday, I think Wednesday is the first class, or the first meeting they're going to have here, AA is coming here 5 days a week. That's fellowshipping. Our house, or God's house, is open up to everybody. The question is us. When was the last time that we fellowshipped as a Christian to somebody? Not fellowship as a friend, but fellowship as a Christian. When you saw somebody down, did you just say, hey, let me pray for you? Or can I pray for you? Don't say, let me pray for you. Say, may I pray for you? When we talk about fellowship, fellowship is like a party that you get invited to. You see, we need to go to where they are. That's the purpose of this place here. How many churches in the world, and I'm not going to pick on any denomination, are they locked up inside of a building, preaching to the righteous, and they're afraid to go outside? How many churches are like that? How many times have we thought ourselves that was the way to go? You get a born-again person here, I'm lost, I love God, goes into the building, and what's he do? He sees, or she sees, that no one goes out. So what does that teach him? Like a child, I can't go out. I shouldn't do that, because the people that are in charge up here are more important than the people down here, and I want to be like the people up here. Let me tell you something. The first rule of any good church, the most important seat is the seat next to the door. Why? Because that's where the sinner comes in when he knows he needs God. The person up here has already been saved. But the person next to the door has said, I'm going to check out God. I'm lost. I need God. That's the most important seat. God came to see him or her. Didn't come up to see the preacher preach the word. He came to see the people that God's preaching the word. The preacher is preaching the word to. We need to start helping each other. We need to literally start helping each other. The Bible says, love yourself, your neighbor as yourself. If you were short of money, yourself, and you knew you had money in the bank, what would you do? You go take some out. If you got some money in your pocket and you're hungry, what do? You go buy yourself something to eat. When was the last time we saw somebody hungry and we didn't give them something to eat? It can be food, it can be spiritual, it can be holding their hand. They can be thinking of ending their life. When was the last time we fellowshiped? That's fellowshipping. Fellowshipping isn't just going into and eating a great meal like on Thanksgiving, which is good, going into the church foyer and everybody saying, look at all these awards we're giving, we're having a good time. That's not fellowshipping. That's just getting together. Fellowshipping is learning. The nature of that. But let's look at the element, the essence or the elements of genuine Christian fellowship. Do nothing, out of Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 through 5. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility. Consider others better than yourselves. You should look not only to your own interests, but interests of others. That's the first element of Christian fellowship. When was the last time you went to a Christian church and had a fellowship dinner and someone looked after your interests? Someone got on their knees and cried and prayed with you. You did. That's not fellowship. That's just a get-together. We in the church have forgotten what fellowship is. And we mixed it with a get-together. Like, you know, my mom used to say, you know, you can count the friends that you have on your hand. But you can't count the number of acquaintances you have. Am I right? We need to look. When are we going to fellowship? Not when we're going to have a get-together. Another part here. Ephesians chapter 4 says, therefore each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor. That does not mean going up to your neighbor and saying, yo, you smoke, you need to stop. You're skanky, you need to stop how you're living. That's not speaking truthfully. That's speaking true truthfully, if you're saying. Now, if you go and you see somebody buying alcohol that you know shouldn't be buying it at 7-Eleven, you don't go over and slap them side of the head and say, what do you think you're doing? You do it with humility. You say, brother or sister, and this is what I would do, because this is what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to say, so you're going out tonight, you mind if I go with you? Let them know you're there. And then as you're going, you talk with them. Wasn't that the AA thing called your sponsor? Well, our sponsor's God. That's our sponsor. You see someone fellowship, come to their aid. Colossians 3:14, after all these virtues, put on love, which binds them together in perfect unity. I love that word, love. Another word for love is charity. King James Version uses that a lot, but you have to look at the difference. We say, love your neighbor as yourself. Truly love the person next to you. If you what I'm trying to say is, as a Christian, we need to start helping each other. Look at this neighborhood out here. There's people that are walking by. People having problems. They don't have jobs. There's people selling drugs. There's people getting high. There's people getting drunk. But what's the traditional Christian do? Say, they're evil. They're going to go to hell. Let's pray for them. You know, I'm tired of people saying, let's pray for them. Let's go and do something for them. Stop giving lip service. You know, I'd rather see a sermon than hear a sermon. I'd rather live a sermon than to speak a sermon. We need to start doing what we're talking about we're doing. I'm tired. Look in St. Cloud, all these churches. I've never seen a city more than St. Cloud. It had so many churches. I was in Tennessee. You know, that's the Bible Belt. There weren't as many churches as I see here in St. Cloud. But you know what? Where are they? They're inside their building. They're not outside the building. There's more people on the beach on Sunday than there is in church. There's more people in the club partying Sunday night than there is worshiping on their knees. There's something wrong with that. Why? Because Christians are what? Hypocrites. Tell you how to live your life. Tell you what God's going to say. They tell you all these things, how it's going to be. Fellowship means do fellowship. Sit with them. If you got a buddy, are you going to tell him how he should live his life or she? I work as a nurse. And I'm a guy, and sometimes I don't like working with number of women. But you know what? I can see a fight going. If a woman goes up to another one and says, what you're wearing, I'm not going to say what they would say. Of course you would never say that. You would, then here they go like that, that's interesting. And then they go to their friend over here and say, you want to see? Go check that out over there. You know? And they do that, or they love the gossip channel. Oh my God, on TV. Man, when in the morning when we get ready to do our patient care, it's at first, they want to hear about something. That's not fellowship. Because let me tell you something. If you're in the mood to talk about somebody, you're in the mood to have somebody talk about you. Fellowship is, you want your best friend to talk about you? Do you know what I'm talking about? The backstabbers? Hi, how you doing? I'm going to have everything go by. He says, you won't believe what they did. Write them off the schedule. I don't want them to work. I can't work with them. And they see you again. Hi, you're doing such a good job. That's not a friend. That's not a Christian. A Christian is the way you live. It's a way of life. It's not Sunday night, Sunday morning, Wednesday. That's just going to church. That's not a Christian. Christian is a way of life. You go in the military. There's a lot of people been in the military. Excuse me for my coughing. That's a way of life, whether you like it or not. You're going to wear your uniform, or you couldn't breathe. You're going to stand up to attention when they tell you. It's a way of life. And they remind you, you're never off duty. When you're in the service, oh, they're big on that. You're never off duty. Don't you think that because formation's over with, and you see an officer, and you tell them what you think of him, it ain't going to happen. It's a way of life. You live 24-7, whether you like it or not. Well, you're a Christian. You have to live that life 24-7. Don't call yourself a child of God just because you go to a church. Don't call yourself a car because you're inside of a garage. You call yourself a Christian by how you live. You call yourself a Christian by what you do. You call yourself a Christian by what's in your heart. Jesus died for us. But yet, we all say He died for us, but how many do what He says? Like He said Himself, how can you call me Lord if you do not do the things I tell you? Am I right? We have to fellowship. We have to support each other. We need to start bringing people, not just like I told my brother over here. I told him straight out, he's visiting us for the first time. And I forgot to get to him. I'm so sorry. I told him, he's coming here. But if he doesn't want to come here, I said, I'll drive him. You can ask him. I will call the pastor of the church he wants to visit and introduce him. Sure, I want him here. But I want to have him in the Christian house. He came here with no job. Now he's sitting in front of, look at that, he's a guest and he's already running the sound system. See, every one of us has a job to do in this world. Are we going to fellowship? Are you going to fellowship? You start fellowshipping, you start having right things happen in your life. You know, that's when you don't need drugs because you got what? Friends. Real friends. You don't need to get high because you're already high with the Holy Spirit. And I have seen that. You can get so high with the Holy Spirit that, let me tell you, I watched this lady. This is the most impressive thing I've ever seen. Here, I want you to see this. This lady is from North Carolina. Hardcore redneck type woman. Very nice. I'm serious, but she has no black friends. She doesn't associate with Spanish people. She's a born-again Christian, though. Mind you, she is born again. She just lives in this little world here. And this Spanish pastor came in. He started preaching. He had an interpreter. And then they started praying, and he pushed the interpreter aside and started praying in Spanish. This lady from North Carolina fell into the Spirit. He was speaking Spanish, but you see, it was the language of the Holy Spirit. She weighs more than me, I'll say that. She did not eat for one day. She could do nothing but giggle all day. I mean, nothing but giggle. She came in that night to church, and her husband said, no, she hasn't been drinking. That's called being drunk in the Spirit. What I'm trying to say is, imagine that. You know, people talk about getting high, and you spend all this money on drugs, you spend all this money on alcohol. Well, you can do it free. God can come into you, and you won't have to care. You know, when you're high, I've never been high, except when they gave me too much stuff at the hospital. And I know I'm lucky. But I don't know what some people go through. But I do know this. I didn't care. I did not care if they cut my toes off. Because, you see, I was feeling good. I called up work, and they told me later on, well, I was really wasted. Because I was calling people at my work asking, what's going on? And they said, you should have heard me on the phone. You see, you can be like with God. I didn't have to pay for it. You see, I'm so in love with God that I forget about every other problem I have. I literally don't care. Because I know God will take care of it. Imagine a high with God. An actual high. You're like, man, I don't care. I'm with God. I'm just chilling. I'm going to praise Him. I'm going to jump. I'm just happy. You ever see people that, oh, I got this. Like when I was in service, they get this new beer. They have 100, 300 million beers in Germany. Oh, you got to try this. This is really good stuff. We should be doing that with Christianity, with God. Well, you got to try God, man. It's awesome. And not be embarrassed. But yet, you're so high with them at that point, you don't care if they don't like it. How many people with drugs? I've seen some people that are high. They don't care if you're not high. They want to show you what they got. Sometimes they get arrested because they show the wrong person. But they want to share what you got. I mean, you get somebody, you ever see someone smoking, they never go, you can't have some. Have some, and it's good. Right? Why can't we do that with God? Why can't we fellowship with God that way? Why can't we not help the next person? I'm not saying whip out the Bible and shove it down their throats and you will be saved whether you like it or not. We're not going to do what they did way back when. But if they see that we're so happy, things are going right, they're going to ask why. What's so good about it? The energy of Christ. And then they start realizing, I don't care about my problems anymore. I honestly don't care that I don't have any money in the bank. That the bank, in fact, is debt collectors, they're calling up and having conversations with them, saying, hey, how you doing? I know you're going to call next week. How's your kids? You know, be friendly with them. You just don't care. You're so in love with God and so happy. And the next thing you know, God's going to speak to your heart and say, listen, I know you like those debt collectors, but maybe you should start paying your bills. And next thing you know, you're putting your money to the side. You're not even worried about where it's coming from, but next thing you know, you got the money to pay the bills. And you're still not worried about that you don't have a job, and things aren't looking good, you don't have a car, but you're in love with God. You're in love with. This is what happens when you fellowship and you're so interested. Well, next thing you know, you have a car. You don't even know where that came from. Someone just gave it to you. Or maybe you just bought it. They said it. One time I was given a car when I was in the Marine Corps. It was an old Omega. It looked like a Nova. It had no shocks on it. It was awesome because it sunk so low to the ground, it could corner like anything else in the world. It was given to me by, believe it or not, a guy who sold vacuum cleaners. So I don't sleep down here. That's how God works with you. That's how this church came to be. When you were there, Pastor Dormer said, you need a church. 2 days later, we had this building. God will provide everything. But first, you have to love Him. You know, you don't see a mom go to the store and say, do you see that child over there? I want to buy him everything he needs. I love him. No, that's not their kid. But when it's the mom of that kid, God forbid you see something wrong about that child. You know that child smacking somebody else in the head. They'll say, you don't know my child didn't do that. You love that child. God loves you the same way. He's going to take care of you. But you got to live. Yeah, I'm coming. Micah, you can come on up. One of them is yours, yes. That's another thing. We're talking about fellowship. We got food in the back. When people are hungry and you have something, you can, would not you feed yourself? But I'm saying we got some food here. And when we close, I want to say, Brother Micah's going through some situations too. And we need to pray for him. In fact, we need to pray for some one person in your life you know. And if you don't know somebody, I want you to pray for the person that you saw on standing in the street corner today. They're going through some situations. Let God be your drug. Let God give you that high. Because when you're involved with God, you don't need anything else. You don't want anything else. You truly don't. And just like, unlike the drug, you don't have to keep on trying to find money to buy it. God will just stay with you. Imagine that, a constant high with God, 24/7, 30 years. You don't care. I've seen people in prison, people locked up, smiling because they're high with God. God has taken over their life. Sure, they've got consequences to pay for. But you don't need the world to survive. You need God to survive. We need to start bringing God into the picture. And last note, I'm not going to say, because I don't like bringing politics in. But remember, Thanksgiving is about saying thank you to God, not to man. Saying thank you for our country, not to man saying thank you for beating whoever at a war. It's thank you, God, for letting me live. Like when you get up in the morning, if one leg doesn't hurt, the other one, thank God for the leg that does not hurt. When you're driving to work and you see somebody next to you, say, Lord, I thank you for giving them a car so they could drive and enough gas for them to reach the point I just saw them at. Because they may not have enough gas to go down the street. When you start thanking other people and praising God for their blessings, guess what? You start getting blessings before you know it. And I'm very serious. Imagine this. You go into Walmart. Do this one time. I challenge you. Go into Walmart and you just be walking around. You see somebody there and say, you know, and you see him smiling, especially when you see him smiling. You say this. I thank you. Just tell him, no, sorry, ma'am. I just had to say this. I'm thanking God that you had a wonderful day today. And just leave. Thank others. Give them praises for what they have. Like Brother Larry's going to leave, graduate Wednesday, but he's staying with the church. That's a gift in its own. He's graduating out of this. And he's going to have a tougher road coming out of Transition House. It's going to all the devils and all the spirits. And this is one reason I'm going to ask right now that Larry to make sure he stays in contact with Brother Hughes, because Brother Hughes has stepped out of that arena, and he's doing great. Start showing that's fellowship. That's real fellowship. When I fall down, you call me. And if I can't help you, I call someone else. I come there. I'm with you. I cry with you. I laugh with you. And I say, I do everything for you. Because you really mean. You really mean. Praise God. Okay, right now we're going to, I always like to say this because there's a few people here. If you haven't accepted God at this point, and you want to have a little taste, just a little taste of Jesus, like that drug dealer says, you have a little taste. Well, you can have a little taste of Jesus. If you need that taste, just let us know. We'll pray for you. And if you already had a taste and you want a big piece, we'll pray for you too. Because you got to get filled in. And God talks about being overflowing. I want to have so much of God that it's just littered the floor. It's just everywhere. I just slip and fall with God. And when you're doing that, you're spending so much time trying to get up in the glory of God. You don't know what's going on outside your area. And you know what? You don't care because you don't need to because God's got your back. He's not going to stab out you. He's not going to talk behind you. He's going to love you. But if you felt like today that you backslid and you love God already, but you've done some things that aren't right, I want to pray for you too. Let's all bow our heads right now. Dear Lord, Father Jesus, I thank you for the present that you gave me, the gift of your blood. Lord, if there's someone here that hasn't accepted you and is reaching up, Lord, I ask you to let them know that you're here and welcome them into your kingdom. And if you're one of those people, just give your life to God right now. Give your problems, I mean literally give your problems to Jesus. If you feel like hurting yourself, let God take care of it. If you got someone after you with money, let God take care of it. If you got political things or government things like court cases, let God worry about it. But if you already accepted God and you said, God, I sinned last night. I thought some things I shouldn't have. I said some things I shouldn't have. I've done some things I shouldn't have. I'm sorry. Let me let you know already, God never left your side. But you just got a little bit stronger. God bless you. He's a God of second chances. A God that will never let you go, no matter what you do. No matter where you are, there is nothing so bad that God will never be with you. He always is. As one man said, open the door and let God in. He's always there. It's us that walks away. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Right now, as we always do this, as we get ready to close, I like to give time to the musicians. And we have musicians are going to pray with their hands. And then we can sing. This is something that I've always done. I just feel that we should, as we get ready to close, that we should leave this place in the spirit, wanting to just thank God. And, you know, just being happy. And Brother Micah, if you could play something up-tempo. Brother Micah, if you could play something up-tempo as we get ready to close with a good song or... Okay? All right. Amen. Thank you.
child or something like that. Or something, you know.
Yeah. You're basically, you're on the train. All right. This is Jack and I'll close it out for it. We've been a ride this train, you know.
Choo choo
train. Your favorite song. She know what I'm talking about.
Which train is it, Jackie?
I hope y'all have a good time here today, and I sure appreciate all the guests coming. Y'all sure have made my day. And from when I was sitting over there with Rio and talking, something just kept going through my mind. Say, Larry, you ain't got good no fucking call. You got a choir right in here. And I believe these little faces in here. Y'all might as well get ready to start. Come on over here and get ready to sing for the Lord. We're going to put some seats back here for y'all to sit on. Uh-huh. They're like heads going like this right here. Mike, you better come on here and get these.
All right.
Okay, let's ride.
Okay.
Okay.
So we're talking about the train.
Yes.
Right? Okay, and the song is?
Okay, get ready.
Okay, you guys go ahead. We're going to see everybody. Stand in our feet, we'll get ready to be on our way out. We'll chime you out with something nice if we can.